Good morning, fifth grade. Today we will be reading chapters 4 and 5 of Jim Ugly. Chapter 4 is titled The Travelers. Jim Ugly leaped off the porch, barely pausing to cast his nose about for the scent, and led me flying along the boardwalk. Once he had a smell on his nose, he followed it as if it was all a wonderful game to play. We passed the general store and the bakery, and crossed the street toward the Smoketree Junction Bank. He hauled up at the stone step and seemed to lose the scent. He seemed disappointed in himself and gave out a small whine. The town dog came trotting over to see what was going on. I think he wanted to wag his tail and get acquainted, but Jim Ugly wouldn't be sociable. The next thing I knew, he picked up the scent as if it hung like a mist along the side of the bank. He shot past the livery stable, and I lost sight of him behind a board fence. I was making an awful racket with my spurs on, but no one bothered to give me more than a glance. When I caught a flash of Jim Ugly again, he was standing on the platform at the depot. He was looking around as if he expected Dad to be there. So that was it, I thought. Dad must have caught a train out of town. Axie had lied to me and everyone else. I had boiled over thinking about it. Had Dad put him up to it? Didn't anybody think about me when they planned to lower that pine box full of ice into the ground? Or even Jim Ugly giving his tail a wag as he heard a horse along the road, as if it might be Dad coming back. Axie could have told me the truth, even if he was just doing what my dad said. He could have trusted me. Nice going, Jim Ugly, I said when I caught up to him on the platform. I came close to giving his head a pat, but I didn't. The station master was polishing the brass telegraph key with his pocket handkerchief when I stepped up. He was tall and thin and seemed to be mostly legs, like a sand crane. Sir, I said, do you recall if Sam Bannock bought a ticket about a week ago? Sam Bannock. I don't recall the name. He from around here? Over in Blowfly. He the one that got thrown by the horse? Yes, sir, I replied. I didn't sell him a ticket to anywhere. Do you know Axie G. Hopper? Maybe he bought it. If Axie bought a ticket, I'd remember, said the station master. He didn't. Dad could have climbed aboard without a ticket, I thought, and bought it from the conductor. Maybe he was being careful not to leave any more of a trail than he had to. What time does the train come through here? I asked. Eastbound or westbound? That stopped me short. I couldn't guess which direction Dad might have gone. What's east? I asked. Mostly desert and prospectors. What's west? Mountains and prospectors. It seemed to me that Dad had had enough of the desert. The station master pulled out his railroad watch. The westbound is due in 1 hour and 28 minutes. I'll buy a ticket. How far? He asked. How far does it go? Sunflower Creek, Red Sky, and Truckee. Just to the next town, I said, and counted out money for a ticket to Sunflower Creek. You'll have to keep your dog in the baggage car. I was about to answer that Jim Ugly wasn't my dog, but remembered that now he was. It was going to be some trouble getting used to. You'd better tie a muzzle on him. You got a piece of rope? I left it behind, but he don't bite. At least I didn't think he would. You couldn't be certain about a thing like that with Jim Ugly. The station master found an old piece of rope and slipped it across the counter to me. The baggage man will be ever so grateful. I waited on the platform for a while. I wasn't anxious to tie Jim Ugly's jaws together. I felt a bit scared of even trying. I'd known him to snap, and he might bite over a thing like that. He meandered off and drank out of the water trough, and I hoped he wouldn't decide to run off when the train came charging in. The town dog came closer with his tail wagging and howdy all over his face. It was as if he was trying to say, I've changed my mind, Jim Ugly. You can be the king of the street now. But Jim Ugly already knew that, and he meandered on back and curled up on the depot platform. That's when I tried to wrap the rope around his jaws. He kept tossing his head so that I couldn't get the loop around. A look like a teased snake sprang into his eyes. My heart began to bang away. I didn't want him to see that I was afraid of him, So I went at it again, and he snapped at the side of my face. I got a loop around his jaws, but the next thing I knew, he had slipped out. "Jim Ugly, stop that. You're my dog now, and you might as well get used to it. Stand still, Jim Ugly." He glared at me, not a sound coming from his throat, not even a warning growl. We stood that way for a while, staring at each other, and I became aware of both the station master watching me and the town dog watching Jim Ugly. "Stop acting so high and mighty," I said. "It's only an old ragged piece of rope. You've been roped before. I ain't enjoying this any more than you are. Now don't you move, Jim Ugly. Is that clear?" I was afraid to try muzzling those teeth again, so I dropped the rope around his neck and made a loose knot. "That's better," I said. "That's more like it." I shot a glance at the station master. "I'll ride the baggage car with him," I said, "and I'll keep the rope on him." "That'll do," said the station master. I sat on the platform and Jim Ugly curled up. Before long, I saw the wagon with the yellow wheels swinging into town. I watched as it drove up the street and into the livery barn. Mr. Cornelius and Wilhelmina came out on foot and crossed the street to the hotel. The train was already in sight when they came sauntering toward the depot. Mr. Cornelius was burdened with 3 brown leather suitcases as brushed and polished as his shoes. Wilhelmina was carrying a white parasol with a breezy snowfall of lace around the edges. For an instant, I wanted to skip and run before they recognized me. But then I realized that they had never seen me before. And they'd never laid eyes on Jim Ugly either. So I calmed myself down. I saw her dabbing at tears with her handkerchief. They appeared to be real tears to me, and I heard her whisper hoarsely, "Poor Sam. Dear Sam, I cared about him so very much. Just do as I say, Wilhelmina." I caught sight of the train way down the tracks, puffing up an advancing tornado of smoke, and suddenly Wilhelmina was beside me. "Dear boy, you're bleeding," she exclaimed. "You've hurt yourself." She began dabbing at my ear with her handkerchief. Had Jim Ugly nipped me? He must have. "Hold it there, child," she said, pressing my fingers to the handkerchief. It felt light as a cobweb. "How far are you going?" "Sunflower Creek," I said. "Have you ever been to the big city?" I should have said no and let it go at that, but I couldn't let her think I was a purebred hayseed. "I've been to New Orleans," I said, "and even San Francisco." I saw Mr. Cornelius look up at the mention of San Francisco, and I wished I'd had better sense. But they didn't put 2 and 2 together. "How wonderful," she said, but I could tell she thought I must be bragging and didn't believe me. "If you get back to San Francisco, you must come to the Mazeppa Theater as Mr. Cornelius's guest. He built it after the last fire." I had sense enough now not to say that I'd been to the Mazeppa Theater once, when my dad had acted there in Danton at the Bastille. "Cornelius, give this wounded child a complimentary ticket. How is your ear?" "Fine," I said, and tried to give her the handkerchief back. It was kind of bloody, and she just smiled and told me to keep it. Had she really cared about my dad? I didn't know what to make of it. The train came huffing and raining sparks, and the conductor stepped down to help Wilhelmina and Mr. Cornelius aboard. I went forward to the baggage car. There was no way Jim Ugly could leap in while I held the short rope around his neck, so I let go. He jumped right on, and we settled ourselves near a shipment of wicker rocking chairs in the corner. The baggage master looked over. "If that dog decides to bite me," he said with a grin, "I aim to bite him back. Tell him that." "Yes, sir," I said. He slid the door of the baggage car shut. Before long, the engineer let out a blast of steam, hit the bell, and we went rattling down the track. Chapter 5. Jim Ugly Follows His Nose. Jim Ugly curled up on the raw plank floor that creaked and shook under our feet. I gazed around at the trunks and suitcases and barrels and boxes, all ticketed and going somewhere, which was more than I could say for myself. I looked at the baggage master, who had freckles as thick as rust spots. "How long to Sunflower Creek?" I asked. He calculated it would be a mite over 2 hours, and I wondered what I would do if Jim Ugly didn't pick up my dad's scent when we got there. I'd reckon I'd buy a ticket to the next stop and keep going until my money ran out. But then what? I shrugged and tried to stop thinking about it. I climbed up onto a packing box and watched out the window for a while. I began to count jackrabbits scared off by the engine and hightailing it through the sagebrush. But after a while, I got tired of that. It seemed to me my dad should have made sure I knew he was alive and fit. He shouldn't have let Exy keep the secret to himself. He shouldn't have played a trick like that on me. The baggage master looked over from his swivel chair. "What you scowling about, kid?" he asked. "The look in your eyes is dark as tar. You and your dog ain't running away from home, are you?" "No, sir," I answered quickly, not realizing I'd let my thoughts show. I must learn to keep my face from advertising everything, like Axie. "I'd put you off this train if I thought you was running away. Truth is, I'm looking for my dad," I said. "It was him that ran off, but Jim Ugly here can track about anything. He's got the scent in his nose, and he's following it." "To Sunflower Creek? That'll be worth seeing." "If my dad got off there, Jim Ugly will know." I was surprised to hear myself make a brag dog out of him and eased off. "I never heard a name like that for a dog," said the baggage master. "It suits him. A handsome dog like that? He's not pure dog. He's part timber wolf." "Looks friendly enough," said the baggage master. "That's because you don't know him," I answered. "He's got a disposition about like barbed wire. He's no mongrel to brag about. No, sir." The baggage master smiled as if he knew more than I did. "If he's a burden to you, boy, I'll be glad to buy him off of you. What'll you take for him?" Maybe I had begun to run down Jim Ugly more than necessary. "He's not my dog to sell," I answered. "And I'm counting on his nose if my dad isn't in Sunflower Creek." When the train hauled up at the depot, the baggage master threw open the door. "We stop here only 3 minutes. Let's see what that wolf of yours can do." I took hold of the rope around Jim Ugly's neck and gave him another close smell of the bullet. "Find him, Jim Ugly," I commanded, and off we jumped. He lifted his nose and began plowing through the smells along the depot platform. He went back and forth, sniffing and panting, and finally I led him back along the tracks in case my dad had jumped off the train before it got to the depot. Through the window, Wilhelmina caught sight of me and waved her fingers. I nodded and kept going, my spurs jingling. But it was clear that Jim Ugly couldn't find the scent. The baggage master began flagging his arm and shouting at me, "Come on, you'll get left behind!" The engineer was already sounding the bell. I pointed to the baggage car and Jim Ugly seemed content to jump back in. "I'll need a ticket to Red Sky." "I'll let you ride free," said the baggage master. "It'll be worth it to see if that wolf of yours can do it." The engine shot out great side whiskers of steam. The baggage master gave me a hand up and slid to the door shut. I pulled off my spurs and stretched out. Jim Ugly slept most of the way to Red Sky. It was a water stop high up in the foothills and smelled of fresh cut pine lumber. But that didn't appear to throw Jim Ugly's nose off. He rummaged about, sorting through all the different odors, and quickly tossed them aside. "Dad ain't here, is he?" I muttered, and Jim Ugly turned his head to give me one of his pointy-eyed looks. There didn't appear to be much in Red Sky but the water tower and the sawmill, and I led Jim Ugly back. "No luck?" asked the baggage master, and I said, "I can't imagine my dad running off to a runty place like that." "Truckee is bigger. It's growing up so fast, I'm told they don't have enough bed bugs to go around. And if your dad ain't there, he likely laid over to change trains. Most folks do." "They have a theater?" "The Magnolia." That gave me a little hope. Dad liked the company of actors, but for all I knew, he hadn't headed west at all. If he'd taken the eastbound train, I was scrambling in the wrong direction. The train began to climb in earnest now, following a snail's trail of switchbacks until we must have risen a mile up the mountainside. The air was getting chillier the higher we climbed. When the engine pulled into the depot at Truckee, it seemed to gasp for air, blowing out thin, ragged drifts of steam. I barely noticed Wilhelmina and Mr. Cornelius leave the train, for once we hit the platform, Jim Ugly was off. It hardly took him a moment to pick up the scent, and I went bounding after him. I did turn back to see the baggage master give me a goodbye wave of the arm. The town was across a wide, rutted street from the depot, and Jim Ugly crossed it as straight as if he were chasing a cat. He went loping around the boardwalk, pausing only a moment here and there to refresh himself with the scent, and turned up a side street. When I caught sight of him again, I saw him scratching at the pine door of a shack sitting on the tree stumps. My heart began to go like thunder. Jim Ugly was so anxious, I figured my dad must be on the other side of that door. It flew open while I was still in the street. "What are you scratching for? Beat it!" It wasn't my dad. It was the man in yellow leg trousers.